हाँ स्टाइल
सर स्टार्ट सर ऑल आर रेडी सर दे आर जॉइनिंग
थैंक यू गौतम गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबॉडी ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर रजिस्ट्रार एंड रजिस्ट्रार ऑफ राजीव गांधी यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ हेल्थ साइंसेस आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस कंटिन्यूड मेडिकल एजुकेशन वेबिनार hosted by RGHS with support from ECHO Foundation. Today's topic is a much needed, much in focus, mucor mucosis in COVID-19. Without wasting much of your time, I would request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. S. Sachidananda, to please deliver his opening remarks. Honorable VC, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mahendra. It's a privilege to be a part of this continuing medical education webinar, which is being organized by Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences. As soon as the second wave started in Karnataka. You are all aware that last year, at the same time, around March, we had the first wave. And we, at that point of time, we never knew what is this COVID. It was a totally a new disease, how it would behave and what things, how it would shape up. What are the drugs that we have and things like that. But it will be the second wave, we are much better off. We now know much of the pathology of the disease, much about the clinical presentation of the disease and the course that it adopts in severe cases. We also have some drugs which are supposed to be life-saving, and also appropriate usage would definitely prevent deaths, mortality in COVID-19. However, a thing that has cropped up very recently in the second wave, whether it is very peculiar to our own continent, our own country, is yet to be seen, because there may be many reasons why this particular mucormycosis, the black fungus, which is colloquially called as a common term used, why it has cropped up, which was not there so widely in the first wave. The same drugs were being used then also, and even now the drugs are not much of changes are there, though one or two drugs, new drugs may have been added. Is it the drugs that we use that is causing the problem? Is it the hygiene that we maintain is causing the problem? Or is it uncontrolled comorbidities, which is also resulting in such problem, is what is an enigmatic disease. It is throwing up new challenges every now and then. We have to face the conditions, try to go to the root cause of the problem, try to address it with the same vigor and valor. Today, we have lined up specialists from Bangalore Medical College and this thing. The list would be definitely put across to you to give us an insight in mucormycosis, how it happens, what are the clinical manifestations, how can we tackle this, and how do we figure out what may be the reason why this small epidemic. In the pandemic, there's a small epidemic sort of a thing. And of course, the government of India now notified, saying that this should be a notified disease. Everybody should report to the authorities if any such cases are encountered. Now, ophthalmologists, ENT surgeons, dermatologists, physicians, maxillofacial surgeon, everybody should be on guard for the slightest changes this condition puts across, and we should be able to diagnose as early as possible, because early diagnosis and quick treatment is the key to contain this particular condition. Otherwise, it has a very fast progressive clinical course, which may end up in fatality. So that's what is the aim. I'm sure all the specialists, all the experts would throw more light on this particular condition, and all the delegates would benefit. At the end of the session, there will be a question answer session, which will also clear most of your doubts. The experts would be more happy to answer that. I wish this would be a very meaningful and interactive session. Over to Dr. Mahendra to continue with the proceedings. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. I now request Dr. Nagaraj to kindly take over and conduct the proceedings.
Good afternoon, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor, the entire team at Rajiv Gandhi University for having me part of this prestigious program. Gautam, can you just share the screen?
Yes, sir. 1 minute, sir. Sharing, sir.
Mucormycosis is a condition which is a very devastating condition, which is a disfiguring condition if you try to manage it medically and surgically, because the surgical procedures, what we do for a mucormycosis is almost on the lines of malignancy, especially in the orbit. And it can be very disfiguring, more so if you do it in a younger individual. So what is peculiar about this mucormycosis you see with COVID? So it is called as COVID-associated mucormycosis, or CIM. Gautam?
Yes, sir. It's sharing, sir. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Next slide, please.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So there is not of negativity involved in this present COVID times. When there is so much of negativity, we get sometimes it will attract more negativity. And likewise, the same is happening with COVID also. Along with COVID, we have got this another pathogen, microbe, which is causing devastating illness. That is your mucormycosis. Next slide, please. So that is why it has become a notifiable disease. This particular disease requires a multidisciplinary approach. You should have a very high index of suspicion, and you should approach this disease on a war footing, because it has got a 50% to 80% mortality rate with the best treatment. And you should, when you tackle this disease, it is not only the mucor which you have to keep in mind. You should keep in mind the COVID part also. And preventive measures are also very important. And it is always important to stress on the preventive measures, because the treatment is very expensive. Surgical disfigurement is more so in a younger individual. Next slide, please. So there are various risk factors which causes this mucormycosis. So basically, in this particular scenario, you should keep in mind COVID-19 is the important risk factor. In addition to that, the COVID-19 patients also, you should keep in mind, might be having the other diseases which were previously the known causes of opportunistic infections for mucormycosis, like transplant cases, uncontrolled diabetes, and other conditions. Next slide, please.
Yes.
So almost all the cases, what are the salient features in the present pandemic? This mucormycosis, most of the cases, or almost all the cases, will be having diabetes. And more so, this diabetic status of febrile diabetes is exaggerated with steroids. This is mainly because of the steroid abuse. And we can see even the distributed medical kit from our government in the earlier days used to carry this dexamethasone tablets. And steroid abuse used to occur, and steroid used to be started as early in the first week of COVID infection. And also because of the injudicious use and high dosage of steroids. These are all the various factors which are the cause of this mucormycosis in COVID patients. In addition to that, there is an indiscriminate use of higher antibiotics, which will destroy the normal commensals. Tocilizumab and immunomodulators, if it is not regulated properly, can also be one of the factors, which is the cause of this mucormycosis. In the first wave, this mucormycosis was commonly seen in the recovery phase, and it was commonly seen in the elderly population. But in the present wave, we see it both in the active phase and in the recovery phase also. And more so, it is seen in all the age group, more so in the younger generation. The role of oxygen delivering system is doubtful, because we have seen mucormycosis in those patients who have not taken oxygen therapy for COVID. Next slide, please. Mucormycosis is a general term for infections caused by a group of organisms, filamentous fungi belonging to the class Gloomeromycetes. It was earlier called as the zygomatosis. The present terminology is Gloomeromycetes, and the commonest organisms are the rhizopus and the mucor. Next slide, please. See, these organisms are ubiquitous, and you should understand that this mucor is not a contagious disease. These organisms, the spores of this mucor, lie around everywhere. They are microspheric, spherical, dark hued spores, which are usually dispersed in the air, commonly seen in the compost, soil, animal dung, and rotten wood material and plant material. And they basically are seen on the decaying plant. Right now it is post-spring, and it is usually common in the summer conditions. That is the reason why it is more in this present scenario. And I think it will be more devastating in Gujarat following the present cyclone there, because it will produce a lot of respiratory illness, and there will be definitely an increased incidence of MUCR, and most of the hospitals in Gujarat are flooded with MUCR mycosis cases. And once the spores fall on the leaves, they germinate there into mycelia, and they form the sporangiophores and the sporangium, and they consume all the carbohydrates present in the leaves there, and they gradually they form this mycelia and sporangium, and these sporangium are very brittle. Next slide, please. And once they burst, the sporangia burst, it will release a lot of spores, and these spores in the outdoor environment can be almost 1000 to 5000 spores per cubic millimeter, whereas indoors it is around 100 to 200 spores per cubic millimeter. And it is more common in our tropical conditions like India, and this particular fungus is thermotolerant. It can survive in a temperature of around 37 degrees. That is the reason it is attacking our the human beings. Next slide, please. So this particular fungus, it is by colloquially called as black fungus. Basically black, it is not a black fungus. Black fungus is the terminology usually given to dermatitis fungus, but this is not a black fungus. Probably the end result of this fungus damage on the host tissue, causing necrosis and dead tissue, which turns black. Probably that can be the reason why this media are calling this as the black fungus. Basically, this will produce invasive inflammation into the tissues, and the cyphal elements will invade the tissues, and most commonly there will be very minimal infiltration of the polymorphonucleocytes, nuclear neutrophils and other things, and sometimes there will be very minimal inflammation, but there will be extensive hyphal involvement, invasion of the tissues, more so the vessels, and this will proceed very rapidly. Next slide, please. The mode of transmission is mainly because of airborne inhalation of spores, more so whenever there is a construction activity, excavation activity, or whenever there is cleaning of the air ducts and other conditions. Iatrogenically, it is also seen during surgery, trauma, burns, direct injections, and it is important to see that very good hygiene, hospital hygiene is maintained in the hospitals when you deal with catheters, bandages, and tongue depressors. And it has also been seen, previous slide, it has also been seen in those conditions wherein some people can consume this Ayurvedic medications containing this MUCR spores. That can be another reason why you can get MUCR also. Next slide, please. So these organisms, the spores are inhaled, and the larger spores, which are around 10 micrometers, they lodge in the nasal turbinates, whereas the smaller ones will reach the lung tissues. And these are initially attacked by the mononuclear cells and the neutrophils. And because of the immunosuppression there, and because of the decreased immunity and a fertile environment, COVID environment, because of the because of hyperglycemic state, these fungi will invade the cells, and there will be acquisition of free ion, which will support the growth of the cyphal elements, and they will invade the vessels also. This angio invasion involves in the growth of this fungal element into the tissue, and it can produce hemorrhage, thrombosis, and necrosis. Next slide, please. So there is a lot of controversy regarding oxygen and MUCR. Some say this oxygen is one of the main source of MUCR, but basically we have seen that there are two types of oxygen, medical grade oxygen and industrial grade oxygen. Basically, medical grade oxygen is pure oxygen, and the industrial grade oxygen can be having other gases also along with oxygen. And most of the time, the delivery system is the same. Supposing if there is a contamination of the cylinders at the source itself, that can be one of the reasons. And most commonly, the delivery system of the oxygen to the patient, probably that is the contamination of those things are one of the main source of infection of MUCR. That is what I personally feel, because of the contaminated cylinders, the unclean cylinders which are sent in the lorries and which are just dumped in the passages and other things. Probably it is more common in those cases wherein you carry cylinders at home and use those cylinders. And along with that, the airway tubes and mask, if hygiene is not maintained properly, that is one of the main reason. And there is a lot of controversy regarding the humidifier bottle as a source of contamination of MUCR, and lot of jugaad has happened, and many people have tried, instead of distilled water, sterile distilled water, they have tried normal saline and methylene blue, but none of these things I don't think will be one of the reasons. And mainly, basically, the main hygiene is the most important thing rather than all the other factors. And this is one of the important thing to see that MUCR doesn't spread in the hospital environment, because one of the therapy which has been described for MUCR mycosis is hyperbaric oxygen therapy. If you just look at it, they say it is an adjunctive therapy, very expensive therapy, practically not possible. And they say oxygen will impair the MUCR growth and improve the neutrophil activity. and it will improve the action of amphotericin B also. If that is the case, I don't think the mucor spores will per se be in the oxygen cylinders. It is mainly the contamination of the conduit airways which can produce this mucor rather than the oxygen per se. Next slide, please. So whenever you suspect a case, you have to take a deep nasal swab, sinus washing, or a bronchial lavage, or a debrided specimen from the endoscope. And next slide, please. And you have to subject it for different investigations. Stains, if you stain it, basically you can see aseptate fungi, which are characteristic ribbon-like and thin-walled with regular diameter and occasional septa and slight branching. On culture, it doesn't produce your classical black spores. Basically, it will produce something like a cotton fluffy or a slate gray appearance of fungi, which you see in Saporat sagar. Next slide, please. These are all the microscopic picture. It is very well seen with the KOH mount. You can use a Gram stain or a GMS stain also. Next slide. Tissue stains like H&E, PAS, and Saporat sagar, you can isolate the fungus. Next slide, please. So basically, COVID mucor disease can occur in many organs. And basically, in the present scenario, it is almost similar to that which occurs in diabetes, where in the predominantly there is a rhino, cyano, orbito, cerebral involvement. Next slide, please. So how do you triage? Whenever a case of suspected COVID-associated mucosis comes to you, basically, first you try to assess the COVID status of the patient. Point out whether it is a COVID-positive mucor or whether it is a COVID-negative mucor, but having COVID signs and symptoms, you can call it as a COVID-suspect mucor. Or else it can be a COVID-recovered mucor also, wherein the patient has recovered from COVID, patient has got mucor. But in all those cases, you have to repeat an RT-PCR because it has been found that in those patients with immunosuppression, the virus can be present even more than 2 weeks in the post-COVID state. And the last category is your non-COVID mucor. So whenever this is one part of it, the second part of it is the staging of the mucor, whether it is confined only to this nose, whether it is involving the nose and the sinuses, or nose, sinuses, and the orbit, or whether it has spread into the cranium. Next slide, please. So the staging, according to our Indian Journal of Ophthalmology, it is called as COVID mucor staging. This will be elaborated by my colleague, Dr. Chinmayi. But in our hospital at Bangalore, Minto Ophthalmic Hospital, we have got a very simplified approach, wherein all the cases which come to the OPD, we categorize it into three categories. One is the vision preserved COVID-associated mucor mucosis. The second is the vision lost with preservation of the extraocular movement. The other one is the vision lost with total loss of extraocular movement. This is useful in our approach, I think, which will be told in detail by my colleague, Dr. Chinmayi. Next slide, please. So these are the charts which we use. This is the flow chart what we use. And this is the pro forma which we have made. Basically, the demographics of the patient is filled there. And rest of the other data, the postgraduate has to just tick, that's all. There is not much of rating involved here. This is very useful in categorizing and triaging the patient in the outpatient. Next slide, please. So I'll just give an example. This is a patient who, this is the first photographs on the left, is a case the patient presented with pain in the eye and without any visual symptoms. And in this condition, when you diagnose a case of mucor, you can call it as a possible mucor in the clinical setting. That is, only the clinical findings are present. And this patient was subjected to a radiological investigation. And in that condition, by combining both the clinical findings and the radiological findings, are supposing if you have done an endoscopy and if you see some lot of exudate and necrosis there in the sinuses, you can call it as a probable COVID-associated mucor mycosis. And you take a tissue biopsy and microbiologically confirm that it is mucor mycosis, then you can call it as a proven case of mucor mycosis. So by triaging, you can just possibly make out whether the patient has got a possible, probable, or a proven mucor mycosis, because this is very important in the management, because you cannot do a disfiguring surgery, an excentration, without a clinically proven mucor mycosis. Next slide, please. So what are the non-ocular symptoms? Most common presentation is sinusitis, just like any other sinusitis. Of course, you get non-specific facial pain, loss of sensation, nasal stuffing, epistaxis, crusting, and the presence of black crusts and eschars in the hard palate and in the nose. Next slide. This is mainly because of this particular organism has got a very high degree of angio invasion, which will produce a lot of devastating changes in the mucosa and in the bone also. From the sinuses, maxillary sinus, it can spread to the art palate, face and ethmoidal sinus. From the sphenoidal sinus, it can present to, we can spread into the cavernous sinus, temporal lobe, internal carotid artery. From the ethmoidal sinus, it can go into the orbit, face and the frontal lobe. Next slide, please. Ophthalmologically, it can present with sudden decrease in the vision, sudden onset of proptosis, ptosis, ophthalmoplegia, in a white eye or an inflamed eye. Clinical signs suggest of uveitis, and sometimes fundus can show ischemic optic neuropathy and central retinal artery occlusion. Sometimes there might be unexplained epiphora or watering of the eye. Next slide, please. So basically, in all these cases, you might require a serial radiological investigation. The investigation of choice is MRI with the contrast. Sometimes it has to be done every two to three days. And based upon the symptoms the patient presents, we can probably roughly say where is the site of the lesion. Next slide, please. This is one of the presentation wherein there is an early involvement of the orbit. The patient usually presents with puffiness of the lids. It can be very minimal or it can be very extensive also. Next slide, please. Ptosis is drooping of the upper lid. Since there are a lot of non-ophthalmologists in the audience, I'm just explaining everything. Ptosis is drooping of the upper eyelid. Here in this patient, you can see the patient has got drooping of the upper eyelid. Next slide, please. You can get chemosis or ballooning of the conjunctiva. You can see the sometimes there may be avascular ballooning of the conjunctiva. This is called as something like an edema of the conjunctiva. This is called as chemosis. Next slide, please. Proptosis is protrusion of the eyeball. It can be very minimal or it can be very gross like this. Along with this, you can get an exposure keratopathy. Next slide, please. And some patients can, most of the young patients, they can present like this with sudden decrease in the vision. And there you can see the classical cherry red spot, what is usually seen in a central retinal artery occlusion. Next slide, please. And this is one of our patients, a 61-year-old male. The vision was preserved. The patient had severe COVID. He had taken all the steroids. And he was recently diagnosed at the time of COVID that he had diabetes, and he was given systemic steroids and oxygen also. And the patient had nasal crust, and a biopsy confirmed that it was probably a aspergillus and methicillin resistant staphylococcal aureus. We should always keep in mind that all cases need not be mucormycosis also, because there are other conditions which are equally opportunistic, like aspergillus infection, which can produce or mimic COVID stresses, though they might not be so life-threatening. Next slide, please. Next slide. So this aspergillus fungus is more of a black fungus. I think if it is a involvement of the orbit secondary to this aspergillus, it should be called as a black fungus, not the mucormycosis. Next slide, please. So management guidelines is very important, early intervention with all the reversal of all the factors which cause a immunosuppression. And this is very, it is very important to remove all the tissues, the necrotic tissue, because only then your antifungal medications will start acting. Next slide, please. The most important is the preventive measures. How can you prevent COVID? So basically you should try to identify the high-risk groups. Who are these high-risk groups? High-risk groups are patients of COVID who are in probably high definition beds, or whether they're in the ICU, they are having uncontrolled diabetes, they are on very high steroids or immunomodulators, and they require a lot of oxygen. These are the categories of high risk factors which you have to find out. And on all inpatients or hospitalized patients, you have to check on day 1 and day 3 and day 7 as per the clinical condition, and you have to document all your findings, both an ENT and an ophthalmic evaluation. You should look for congestion, chemosis, pupil reaction, ocular motility, and fundus central retinal artery occlusion. And at the time of discharge also, every case has to be seen once again, and every weekly, all the signs and symptoms have to be noted in all the cases. And radiologically, if possible, if it permits, you can, in all the high-risk category group, you can have a radiological imaging, and you can send the patient also to get a baseline value. Next slide, please. So it is very important to educate the society about mucormycosis by giving appropriate handouts, and you should curtail the injudicious use of steroids, immunomodulators, and antibiotics. And one important factor is the mask factor, and double masking is very important. And basically you should tell the patients to maintain very good mask hygiene, and preferably you should tell them to discard the cloth mask probably every week. They should not reuse the same mask, because that moisture content in the mask can harbor the fungi fungi there, and that can also produce this thing also. And oral hygiene is one of the most important factor in the prevention of mucormycosis. Basically, you should tell them to change the toothbrushes every week. And in an hospital environment, it is important to maintain periodic care sampling of the ICUs and the critical care units. And humidifiers hygiene has to be maintained. The group D workers there have to be told to maintain proper hygiene. With the same hands, they shift the cylinders, they touch the mask and other things that should not be permitted. And COVID recovered patients, once they recover, you should tell them that they should be confined indoors till they get the natural immunity, probably for the next 2 to 3 weeks. And because the spores right now in the summer time, it is very high, the content in the atmosphere outdoors. So basically, it can result in mucormycosis. And basically, if patients are into gardening and farming, we should tell them to curtail those activities right now. So an handout, next slide, please. It is a good thing our government has already prepared an handout which can be given to the patients. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mahendra.
Hello.
Mahendra.
Sir. Dr. Nagaraj?
Yeah.
Sir, tell me, sir. You can hand over to the next speaker, please.
I call upon the next speaker, Dr. Ravi Shankar, professor of ENT.
We'll take morning. The questions at the end.
I would like to invite Dr. Ravi Shankar, professor and head of the Department of ENT, Boring and Lady Curzon Hospital, Bangalore. Dr. Ravi Shankar, please.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay. Gautam, actually, I'm not able to share the screen. Can you do it for me?
Yes, sir.
PPT.
Yes, sir.
I think you had to skip few slides. We'll go. And sure. Before that, I thank the opportunity given from the RGUHS. I want to thank Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir and also Mahendra Sir and all the team. Thanks for the opportunity. So, Dr. Nagaraj has given a good introduction about why it is being caused and what is the background. So, almost everyone is aware now. The problem is, everyone is also panicking. Yeah, at this stage, one thing which is most important from the clinician's perspective is have a heightened sense, heightened suspicion, degree of suspicion can pick the cases early. So we have all learned the predisposing factors. So in that, the good glycemic control is the most important when during the period of during which they are suffering from COVID. I think my colleague Dr. Prashant will be dealing with that in detail. So go to the symptoms slide. Gautam.
Sir, nim slide nimatrane idare illi kalisila.
WhatsApp.
Is this, sir?
Bantu. Idena?
Banta. One nimisha, nange kanista illa.
Sir, is this one?
Yeah. Correct.
Yes.
So go to the symptoms slide.
Next.
This one. Before this.
Previous slide, go.
Apart from ophthalmological symptoms, together with, we can have fever, nasal congestion, purulent discharge, sometimes brownish, and headache. This is one paramount important symptom. because of the involvement of the maxillary nerves, which is behind the where the predilection of mucormycosis is to the sphenoid and maxillary bones. So behind the maxillary bone in the pterygopalatine fossa, usually there is the disease will be present. So that causes involvement of the maxillary nerve, which causes paresthesia and neuralgic pain in the central face, and it will have severe headache along with symptoms of sinusitis, nasal stuffiness, congestion, and facial pain. So along with this, there can be the dark colored patches visible on the palate, or sometimes in the very advanced cases, even on the cheek can be seen. Next slide, please, Gautam. So again, this is divided into early, intermediate, and late. See, this we have already discussed. The next one. So these are some of the pictures of very advanced mucormycosis. Next. Next. So it is staged typically into stage 1, 2, 3, 4. Basically because of the, by the involvement of either within the nose, nasal cavity, and involving the paranasal sinuses, one or more sinuses, and then orbit and intracranium. But typically this will not be limited. When there is involvement of the nasal cavity, almost always there will be involvement of sinuses, or there will be involvement of the orbit, and in advanced cases, intracranial extension will also be there. But as I told you earlier, typically this involves the middle turbinate area and the osteometal complex region. Then it will cause congestion and inflammation within the maxillary sinus. Rarely involves ethmoid and frontal sinus, but most commonly maxillary and sphenoid. And then from behind maxillary, it will involve pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa, and then ascends to orbit. From orbit through the cavernous sinus to the intracranium. This is the typical route. So the next and the next slide. Next. A degree of suspicion is required. So, but now I think everyone is suspicious because has the drug, that is the irony, from those cases. How we can do that? So there are typically four scenarios. Active COVID with active mucor, active mucor after COVID, then again suspicion of both the things, suspicion of mucor and suspicion of COVID, and suspicion of active infection of COVID has to be ruled out, because the prognosis and the modalities which can be taken up during active infection of COVID and mucor is very difficult. A new set is emerging in every hospital, I believe. The people who will be admitted with active COVID, they go on to develop mucormycosis. That is also a new one. They will not be having mucor earlier when they are not admitted, but in the hospital they are acquiring. So diagnosis is by nasal discharge, which will be sent for microscopy and also histopathology. But this is typically will not get the result. The positive result by microbiologist is quite difficult to isolate the fungus. So the MRI T2 weighted image with gadolinium enhancement and fat suppression, that is very important. That gives, MRI gives important information. First, it confirms the diagnosis or almost gives a strong suspicion. And also it will tell me the extent of debridement required. Next slide. Next. So MRI findings will be mucosal thickening with irregular patchy enhancements. Enhancement is the early sign. And the typical black turbinate sign, sentinel sign also known as. So this is because the middle turbinate, which has a lot of end arteries, is the first one to get necrosed. That is the way where there is no enhancement. The necrosed area will not enhance, but the surrounding area will have, there is intense inflammation, which will take up the contrast, and that will tell me the extent of debridement required. And also MRI will give me the indication, the blood flow patterns, intracranial blood flow pattern, and also intracranial involvement due to mucus. So MRI with contrast is the investigation of choice. CT will show enhanced the mucosa, the necrosis can be shown when they say it can show the bony erosions, but that is not much important to me. Even the normal looking bone can harbor disease behind it, typically behind the posterior wall of maxilla. If I just see the CT and operate, I may miss the necrotic tissue behind the maxilla. See, that is why MRI is most important. Next slide, please. So these are the typically some representative images. And the next. Medical management will be in detail dealt with Dr. Prashant. So skip this slide. Yeah, the surgery, I'm very sorry, I could not post certain surgical photographs because I'm still operating and I've just joined in the middle. So what we do is, through the endoscope, approach the nasal cavity, debride the all the necrotic tissue, expose the maxilla completely, and eradicate the disease from the maxilla, then chisel out the posterior wall of the maxilla, then we will encounter the pericoperitone and the infratemporal fossa along with the mandibular, the maxillary nerve, and the third part of the maxillary artery. So we dissect and delineate all the, debride the necrotic tissue there. And also there will be extension to infratemporal fossa can be dealt with. Then we expose the sphenoid sinus and also expose, clear the maxillary, the ethmoid sinuses. And if orbit is involved, we enter the orbit through the medial wall of the orbit and also clear the orbital disease through this route. And if the enucleation is required, we will take the help of the ophthalmologic colleagues, and also we will take the help of maxillofacial surgeons if there is involvement of the palate. And if there is intracranial extensions, the help from the neurosurgeons are required. So post-surgery, we need to inspect the cavity regularly. They say typically liposomal amphotericin can be given up to 7 days. And if the cavity is healing well, there is no recurrence, we can switch over to oral posaconazole with a bridge therapy. 2 days, we will introduce posaconazole along with amphotericin B, then slowly stop amphotericin B and start oral posaconazole. They have to be asked to repeatedly clean the cavity and follow up at least twice in a week for the first month and every week later for the next month, and once in 15 days for another 2 months. And with all these things, with the availability of drugs, still the mortality is around 30-40% after treatment. But without treatment, it's almost certain. It's high mortality is there. So let us all work together and fight this problem. So thank you. I'll hand over the stage to the next speaker, sir.
Dr. Nagaraj?
Yeah, I call upon Dr. Prashant. professor of medicine from Bangalore Medical College to take over. You'll be dealing with the medical management of mucormycosis. This is one of the most important aspect of mucor management, wherein we ophthalmologists and ENT surgeon are just part of the treatment, but the main treatment are the heroes here, Dr. Prashant. Can start, sir. Please unmute.
Dr. Prashant?
Sir, please unmute, sir. It's done, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Prashant from Department of Medicine, Bangalore Medical College. Once again, thanks to all of you, Rajiv Gandhi University, the Vice Chancellor, all the honorable members in the committee. Thank you so much for inviting me for this particular session. Can we start the slides?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, skip this slide, please. Yeah, now, till now, I think Dr. Ravi Shankar and Dr. Nagraj, professors of ENT and ophthalmology, have given a wonderful introduction to this topic. Now, going forward, we have some wonderful things to discuss in this particular problem. Mucormycosis is not only difficult to diagnose, but it's also difficult to treat. So recently, there was a consensus between CDC, America, and European Confederation of Medical Mycologists, saying that one world, one guideline. We'll all have one guideline and we'll all stick onto it, both in terms of medical management. Surgical management becomes relative because that depends on what exactly they're dealing with. Now, it's already been discussed as to be told as zygomycosis. Next slide, please. I'll skip this slide because it's already been dealt with, Dr. Nagraj, sir. There are major risk factors. We have been talking of so many things, but we have to discuss about this because COVID patients coming to us and non-COVID patients also coming to us have several risk factors, like stem cell transplant, solid organ transplant patients, chemotherapy patients, uncontrolled diabetic patients, HIV patients, other immunosuppression states, steroid use, abuse, overuse, whatever we can say, dialysis patients, neutropenia patients due to many reasons, graft versus host diseases, and finally, the most important part now, COVID patients. Now, these set of group of patients have major risk factor with regard to mucormycosis. Next slide, please. Now, the spectrum of illness, we have been concentrating on rhino-orbito-sino-cerebral mucormycosis, but it does not restrict itself to only this part of the body. There are other variants also called the pulmonary mucormycosis, the cutaneous mucormycosis, soft tissue mucormycosis, gastrointestinal mucormycosis. In that, abdominal mucormycosis special variant is the renal mucormycosis. All this will be dealt in brief here. Next slide, please. This has already been dealt with, but here there's an interesting point. What the epidemiologists have come across so far is patients who develop this part of infection or this particular infection rarely develop lung infection. We don't know what is the reason, but people who develop rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis seldom develop lung infection. As what we have seen, it usually originates in this part of the body and can spread to various other parts. Next slide, please. This is a picture to show the rhino-orbitocerebral and some form of cutaneous mucormycosis. You can see the extensive necrosis, eschar being present there, the swelling and all those things. It's quite disfiguring also. Next slide, please. Let's deal with pulmonary mucormycosis. As what Dr. Nagraj rightly said, it's through inhalation route. And most of these patients have either profound neutropenia or poorly controlled diabetes patients who are graft versus host diseases. Most of these patients have prolonged fever. Sometimes it may be so happening that these patients come to you with only fever, with no other symptom. And we may just be ignoring so many things that it may be another infection or something else. And sometimes these patients being immunocompromised may be asymptomatic as well. Radiological findings depend on the configuration, size, number, and distribution of the lesions. I'll discuss this in the investigation part. And it can spread to contiguous organs. An example, from the diaphragm, it can go to the abdomen. So there can be an extension from the pulmonary to the abdominal cavity. Next slide, please. The cutaneous mucormycosis and soft tissue mucormycosis is common in most of the immunocompetent patients also. Most of these patients are healthy individuals, but when they get exposed to some traumatic injury, some motor vehicle accidents, from explosives, some surgery or burns, these patients can present with abscess, skin swelling, necrosis, dry ulcers, eschers, which are characteristic in this nature. We have seen that in the diagram. So this can also be not neglected in patients coming to us. Next slide. Gastrointestinal form is a rare manifestation of mucormycosis. But these patients, especially with COVID, they can present with gastrointestinal symptoms as well. They can present with nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, which may be a part of mucormycosis. It is more common in neonates where the mortality is very high. And in some parts of rural India and China, it is seen even in immunocompetent folks. Next slide. Now, let us deal with COVID-19 with mucor. Most of these cases in the initial part were reported from parts of Delhi, Ahmedabad, Bangalore, and some parts of Karnataka and Mumbai. Now, Rajasthan and 5 other states have recently declared this to be an epidemic of mucormycosis. Most of these patients are diabetic population, immunocompromised patients, inadvertent, prolonged, or inappropriate use of steroids. Most of these patients have been weak because of the COVID itself. Post-COVID discharge, most of these patients can come. They may be on dialysis. They may be immunocompromised due to many other reasons. Cancer patients, patients who have been administered with poor hygienic conditions of oxygen and high flow machines, poor food hygiene, which has not been taken care of. But one important interesting fact according to CDC is that it cannot spread from one person to another or from an animal to a person. So it can only spread through the other fomites substances can only spread from these substances like oxygen administrating mask or something else. Next slide, please. So how do we approach a patient with mucormycosis? Next slide. Now, this is a detailed slide where you can understand what are the risk factors associated. For example, neutrophilic patient, stem cell therapy, solid organ transplant, diabetic population, post-trauma patients, many patients who have no other underlying disease where they present with only prolonged fever or only hematuria or blood cultures. These are the patients who present to us with varying manifestations. In most of these patients, you need imaging as the first line investigation because as what we have already discussed, investigations through other modalities take a lot of time. So either CT scan or an MRI of the particular part, plus or minus contrast, depending on the situation and the renal status of the patient. If the creatinine is high, we cannot give the contrast. We have to get the imaging done. Timely imaging can give an early diagnosis. Once we do the staging there, then we go for the microbiological aspect as what we have already discussed. Unless we prove it, we can't go for extensive therapy here. Now the sampling part and the serology part, I'll be discussing in detail in the investigation part. Next slide, please. So let us go to the radiological diagnosis first. Next slide. So this is the HRCT scan done, and you can see an arrow mark there showing that inverse or reverse halo sign. Usually you find a halo sign where there is central opacity followed by peripheral clearing. Here there is central ground glass opacity followed by peripheral opacity. This is typical of a pulmonary mucormycosis. So there are various stages of involvement, pleuroparenchymal involvement, only parenchymal involvement. So many features are seen in this particular bag. Next slide, please. Now, investigations, as what we discussed, the reversed halo sign, what we discussed. And there are other findings like vessel occlusion on CT pulmonary angiography. The rhinocerebral variant, MRI, is very strongly recommended, and sir has already discussed about it. The abdominal variant, contrast enhanced CT is very much strongly recommended, and renal variant CT KUB is recommended. In view of rapid progression, serial CT imaging or MRI imaging is strongly recommended because most of these patients are unstable and we need to do rapid diagnosis. So it is strongly recommended these patients have to be followed up serially. Next slide, please. This is an MRI image of the brain. You can see extension of this into the parenchyma, the cerebral cortex also. There's cerebral abscess there. Various stages of sphenoidal sinus involvement, the orbital involvement, so many features are being seen there. This tells the extent of involvement of the disease. Next slide. This is also another one where there is extensive destruction of the frontal lobe there. There's abscess there. The orbital destruction is being seen. The bone is already destroyed there. Abscess formation, so much of damage has been seen there. So that is what we were discussing, the extent of surgery that we have to do. And these patients are subjected to surgery is very extensive and very deforming also. Next slide. This is also the same thing. The thickening of the orbital plates and the mucosa is thickened there. Entire destruction of the plates. Also, there's extension to the cerebellum also. It's very clearly seen that it's an extensive disease. So even though superficially it may appear that it is not an extensive one, once the imaging is being done, we understand what is the depth of the disease there. Next slide. So non-enhancement of the nasal turbinates, as rightly told as black turbinate sign, thickening of the nasal mucosa, turbinates, septum and nasal floor, bony erosion, orbital invasion, facial swelling, osseous erosion and extra sinus extension also late radiological signs. Next slide. Now histopathology. Now we have to depend on this because we need to really prove whether it's mucormycosis or not. So based on the suspicion, we start with the investigation. We do the direct microscopy of the clinical specimens. Now, since we have fluorescent brighteners like chalcophorolite and blancophore, these organisms can be picked up early. To confirm an infection, we need a non-pigmented hyphae showing a tissue invasion, which can be stained variously with hematoxylin, eosinophilin, periodic acid shift, or GMS stain can be used for this purpose. Next slide. Now, histopathologically, this has already been discussed. The hyphae are variable in size, 6 to 16 microns. They are non-septate or quasi-septate. They are wide, irregular, and ribbon-like in nature. And most of these patients have either right angle or obtuse angle of branching. The culture of the specimen is strongly recommended to find out what genus and species we are dealing with. Incubation is typically done at 30 degrees and 37 degrees in separate culture media, which is strongly recommended. The SDA agar or a potato express agar is commonly used for this purpose. The duration of growth is 3 to 5 days. They are usually growing fast-growing organisms, and usually it takes around 700 to 900 rupees for the report as the cost, and it's quite reasonable. Next slide, please. There you can see the various the hyphae there, the obtuse angle branching there, and you can also see the electron microscope of that. It's a flat ribbon-like and sometimes irregular also. Next slide, please. This is the same thing. You can see various phases of multiplication of that fungi there. Next slide. There are other lab methods. Off late, the most interesting part is the MALDI-TOF. This is matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization time of flight. Now, what was earlier happening is you have to wait for 3 to 5 days for the culture report to come. This particular technique utilizes a technique called mass spectrometry, where the ionization is done by a laser. Next slide, please. Yeah, where the matrix is basically subjected to a flash beam of laser, which ionizes the entire particles. And then there's an electric field generator which segregates the particles based on the density. The lightest one reaches the earliest and the heaviest one reaches the latest. Previous slide. Now, basically, this is done in several parts of India, in Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, Central Research Facility of Indian Institute of Delhi, IIT Delhi, Homi Bhabha Institute in Pune is the government institutes. There are several other private institutes doing that. The cost of it in IIT Delhi is 750 rupees for commercial purpose. In commercial labs like Lal Path Lab, they're charging around 3,500 to 5,000 rupees. The turnaround time, that is the time required for diagnosis, is just 24 to 36 hours. That makes it rapid diagnosis, so you can definitely proceed with the procedures. Now, there are other immunohistochemistry and PCR techniques, but these are not commercially available and they may not be available for your timely diagnosis, but they're only for epidemiological purposes, available in all research labs, not in commercial labs. Next slide, please. Next slide. Now, medical treatment. Having diagnosed this particular problem, we need medications to treat this particular problem. Now, mainstay here is control of diabetes, good hygiene, control of secondary bacterial infections, and good nutrition. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy role has not been established so far. So what drugs do we have? The traditional amphotericin B deoxycholate, which is not supposed to be given nowadays according to CDC guidelines, but when there is no other availability, you can go with this drug. Liposomal amphotericin B is the drug of choice. If it is not possible or due to some constraints, you are not able to give amphotericin, posaconazole, isavuconazole are definitely recommended. These two drugs are called as salvage therapy in mucormycosis. Echinocandins like caspofungin, they are not very effective, and CDC does not recommend them to be a line of therapy for these patients. But the simple reason is, first of all, in vitro activity, caspofungin has no activity in mucormycosis. Second of all, though there is in vivo case reports suggesting that caspofungin may really work on these patients, it cannot be given as a recommendation. And some of the, even some of the flowcharts and some of the guidelines, they have shown itraconazole to be effective in these patients, but as such, the WHO and CDC does not recommend itraconazole for the therapy of these patients. Next slide, please. Okay, now let us go by the drug, their cost, and total cost per patient. most of these drugs which are available are quite expensive, and the cost of therapy is alarmingly high. For example, liposomal amphotericin B, which is a treatment of choice, is available as 50 milligram vial. It costs around 3,000 rupees per vial, and you need around 5 to 6 vials per day at 5 to 10 milligram per kg body weight per day. So minimum duration, if you take around 14 to 20 days, it may come to around 4,20,000. It's quite alarmingly high. Posaconazole and isavuconazole, both are supposed to be the salvage therapy. They are very expensive, in fact. IV preparation is available at 14,000 rupees per vial, 300 mg. 100 mg tablet is available as 418 rupees per tablet. Minimum duration of therapy is around 3 to 6 months. That comes to around average around 180 days. The therapy cost can be around 3 lakh rupees. That's also quite high. Isavuconazole is available as IV preparation, which costs around 8,000 rupees per vial. 100 mg capsule are available. Each tablet costs 2,100 rupees. So the cost of therapy for 180 days will be 7,56,000 rupees, alarmingly high. Caspofungin, it's available as 70 milligram, 50 milligram vial. Both are available at around 8,000 rupees per vial. So even if you take this as a 14-day therapy, if nothing else is available, cost of therapy is around 1 lakh rupees. Next slide, please. Now, how do these work? Amphotericin B, which is the drug of choice, liposomal, of course, it binds to the fungal cell membrane, ergosterol, and thereby creates spores in it, causing leakage and disruption of the cell membrane cell death. This is one of the best drugs available as of now and is a drug of choice. When it's not possible to give this, you have to go for the rescue therapy or salvage therapy. But adverse events one has to look for is most common is flu-like illness when you start giving this infusion. It is nephrotoxic. So one has to monitor the renal parameters very carefully. Along with that, electrolyte imbalances are very common. It can produce hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, sometimes rarely hyperkalemia also, seizures, hypotension, GI side effects. Now, liposomal amphotericin B, on the other hand, is similar in action, but because of the preferential liposomal binding, the nephrotoxicity is almost negligible. And it's a very safe drug. And there are less nephrotoxic and flu-like illness is almost very much, but the cost is a little high. Posaconazole is a CYP3A4 inhibitor. So this is one drug which has major drug interaction with drugs commonly used in our clinical practice, like statins, calcium channel blockers, HIV drugs, many antibiotics, psychiatric drugs. So we have to look for a lot of interactions there. This particular group of drug belongs to azole group of drugs, and it binds to lanosterol, 14-alpha-demethylase, ergosterol producing enzymes. So it's a key enzyme for ergosterol synthesis. So once the cell membrane is disrupted, the fungus dies. But here there are some unique side effects with this drug, such as GI side effects is common. There is hair loss in these patients, nail pigmentation, hepatotoxicity, peripheral edema, hypokalemia, and leukopenia. So one has to watch for these symptoms of toxicity in these patients. And very interestingly, this drug cannot be given in pregnancy or in breastfeeding. And when EGFR is less than 20, this particular drug is contraindicated. Now, isavuconazole also belongs to the azole group of drugs, but there's some difference of pharmacokinetics with this particular drug. So this has particular ritonavir, digoxin, and tacrolimus. These drugs, when they are being used commonly along with this, has to be carefully monitored. The mechanism of action being similar, almost all the side effects are there, except hair loss and nail pigmentation is not unique to this particular one. But these patients should be very cautious regarding QT prolongation, or short QT syndromes patients can produce life-threatening arrhythmias. And it cannot be given in population less than 18 years of age group, and no breastfeeding is allowed in this patient also. Echinocandins, they have interaction with respect to NNRTI, that is HIV drugs, tacrolimus, phenytoin, rifampicin. Most of these drugs cannot be given, and mainly dexamethasone. That is one thing we have to understand here. It's a non-competitive inhibitor of beta-1,3 D-glucan, which is cell wall synthesis necessary enzyme. So there is no in vitro activity against mucor, but in vivo, there are some case reports available. Here, most common side effects are GI side effects and flu-like illness. Next slide, please. Now, if there is a renal impairment, because as we're getting a lot of patients with dialysis and things, now, do we do something about this when patient comes with a renal impairment? Amphotericin B, for all traditional purposes, should not be given in patients with a chronic kidney disease who are not on dialysis, especially EGFR being 20 to 50. Some other drugs are preferable there. If the patient is on a renal replacement therapy, like a dialysis, Patient can receive the regular dose of 0.5 to 0.7 milligram per kg after dialysis thrice a week. Liposomal amphotericin B is tolerated in 5 milligram per kg body weight without any renal adjustment in these patients. Posaconazole is well tolerated in patients with CKD up to eGFR of 20, but case reports of acute kidney injury have surfaced up with posaconazole, so one has to be very careful with them. Isavuconazole and caspofungin do not require any dose adjustment in bevacizumab. Next slide, please. Okay, now we have a master chart here. Now suppose we have a patient with mucormycosis and we have confirmed them. Now we have surgical debridement going hand in hand with the medical management. The first line of therapy is liposomal amphotericin B. Now there's a word of caution there. Don't slowly escalate the dose. Unlike we do with other conditions where there's gradual escalation, please straight away go with 5 to 10 milligram per kg body. Especially if there is CNS involvement, straight away start with 10 milligram per kg body weight from day one, because they are very invasive organisms and they can lead to a rapid fatality. If the patient has a solid organ transplant or a stem cell transplant, you can straight away go with again 10 milligram per kg body weight from day one. Now patients presenting with renal compromise, there's something called a salvage therapy recommended by CDC. The first drug of choice there is posaconazole. It has to be given 300 milligram twice a day on day one, followed by 300 milligram per day continuously thereafter. Usually the recommendation is up to 6 months. Isavuconazole, on the other hand, should be given 200 milligram 3 times a day on first and second day, followed by 200 milligram per day daily. Now, suppose you don't have liposomal amphotericin B in the option, you can straight away start with posaconazole or isavuconazole. Posaconazole is also available as suspension. And if you don't have any of these options, the last option is the traditional amphotericin B, which is cheaper, but not very effective and a lot of toxicity is there. Now, once we see whether there is responsive or non-responsive or toxic, we subsequently divide this patient and triage accordingly. Now, suppose these patients become stable. And once you start with liposomal amphotericin B and you see that the patient has good stability and response is quite good, you can change over from IV medications to oral medication. A drug of choice will be either posaconazole or isavuconazole. Suppose the patient is progressive in nature, you continue with the same medication and wait for the response and see if the surgical aspect has been taken care of properly. If that is not there, definitely we can revise this surgery. But there is one unique factor about these guidelines, that none of these drugs can be combined. Combination of any of these azole drugs with polyenes, that liposomal amphotericin B with either posaconazole or isavuconazole, has not been recommended, as there is no increase in clearance, but increase in toxicity has been noticed. And it also increases the cost of therapy. Once these patients land up with some toxicity, either because of the azoles or the polyenes, you can switch over from either of the drugs. Suppose you're giving liposomal amphotericin B, you can switch over to the azoles or the either. So in either case, monitoring of these patients and serial follow-up of this is very much important. Next slide, please. Duration of therapy. The most enigmatic question that anybody can ask is how long to give therapy for these patients. These patients' median duration of therapy as per CDC, if you are a hospitalized patient, is around 3 months of liposomal amphotericin B. But since now we have recent drugs like posaconazole, isavuconazole, we can switch over once the initial part is over to the salvage therapy. Median duration with isavuconazole in their studies is 84 days. And posaconazole, they have ranged from 1 week to 3 years. However, most of these recommendations harp in between around 6 months of therapy of these medications, since the clearance time is quite long in these patients. Surgical debridement should be parallel along with it, and it should go hand in hand. There should be no overlap there. Medical management should continue. Surgical debridement should continue. In renal failure, especially patients who are not on dialysis, posaconazole or isavuconazole are more effective and should be preferred compared to the liposomal amphotericin B, because somehow they feel that the output with these patients with posaconazole and isavuconazole is superior to liposomal amphotericin B. And it should be continued with serial monitoring, with imaging and other things, until the reconstitution of the host immune system occurs and satisfactory improvement occurs and the consultant is happy about the improvement of the patient. And maintenance therapy can be given with these oral drugs. Next slide, please. What are the complications? As we have already dealt with, deformity, disfigurement, mortality is already there. Along with that, blindness, meningitis, meningoencephalitis, hemiplegia, hemiparesis, brain hemorrhage, brain abscess, osteomyelitis, pulmonary hemorrhage, pulmonary infarction, GI bleed, fungemia, multi-organ dysfunction and death, pulmonary cavity, fungal balls, hemoptysis, All these things can occur in these patients. Next slide. What are the poor prognostic factors? Delayed diagnosis, delayed arrival, delayed treatment, first line of poor prognostic factor. These patients do not make up to their intimate goal. Presence of hemiplegia at the onset or hemiparesis is a bad prognostic sign. Bilateral sinus involvement, presence of leukemia, renal dysfunction, chelation therapy, or patients who have rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis, they are aggressive diseases. In spite of the best treatment, the mortality is very high. Next slide. Mortality. The CDC has recommended, given a guideline based on the epidemiological data they have found out, the overall mortality with all these patients is around 17% to 54%. If only sinus infection is there, it's around 46%. Rhino-orbitocerebral, 30% to 70%. Pulmonary involvement, 76%. Disseminated, 96%. GI involvement, 40%. And recently, with inappropriate steroid usage, it can be up to 30% to 60%. But this is only data regarding the CDC. We don't have our own data to say what is the extent of mortality that we have. Next slide, please. Do's and don'ts in COVID, especially with mucor. The ICMR has recently released 2 days back a guideline on what to do and what not to do. Control of hyperglycemia is rule number one. In all these patients, especially most of these patients become hyperglycemic with steroid use or abuse. Monitor glucose very carefully, post-discharge also. Many patients are let off without monitoring when they have become hyperglycemic. They could be diabetics or they could turn diabetic because of steroids. So judicious use of steroids, correct timing, correct dosage, duration and follow-up is very mandatory. Use clean sterile water for humidifiers during oxygen therapy, and use of appropriate antibiotics, antifungal therapy is very important. What should not be done? Don't miss warning signs, like a simple nasal blockage should not be considered as bacterial sinusitis and be let off. You should investigate the patient and find out if the patient does have a mucormycosis. And do not hesitate to seek aggressive investigations like the MALDI-TOF, because these give you early diagnosis, and early diagnosis is always the key to treatment in this patient. And do not lose crucial time to initiate treatment for mucormycosis. Next slide, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. That was an excellent presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I think you will be having a lot of questions regarding the management. Now I welcome my colleague, Dr. Chinmayi. She is an associate professor in ophthalmology at Minto Ophthalmic Hospital, Bangalore Medical College. She'll be dealing about the management of COVID-associated mucormycosis from the ophthalmic point of view. And I welcome Dr. Chinmayi.
Oh, thank you very much, sir. So at the outset, I thank the university and the VC for this opportunity for me and also for all of us to have this interaction. I know most of our colleges were already busy with COVID, and now our situation has become like from the frying pan into the fire directly. So all were overworked with COVID, and now we had this mucor added to our wounds. So I will be dealing with the ocular manifestations and the management. Already Dr. Nagaraj sir has explained in detail about the ocular manifestations, and I will go ahead with the staging of the ocular disease and how we go about with the treatment. Is my slide visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Okay. So the ocular manifestations are very important in mucor, because many a time the sinus disease may not be visible. The sinus is not seen by everyone, but the eye manifestations are visible to everyone, and that's one of the reasons why ophthalmologists are sometimes the first people to have the mucor to their clinics. Although it's a systemic disease, many a time it's the eye manifestation which catches the patient's attention, and that's why they seek treatment. And as Dr. Prashant has already told, early recognition of symptoms is the first important thing to mitigate the mortality in such situations, and having a high index of clinical suspicion. So we should not brush these cases which come as redness of the eye as either conjunctivitis or hemorrhage or something. If a patient has recovered from COVID, you have high clinical suspicion. Even if we overdiagnose, it's okay, but no underdiagnosis of mucormycosis. confirmation of the diagnosis by the clinical and radiological features, if possible, with the nasal swab also, and initiation of aggressive surgical and medical therapy by a multidisciplinary team. So all this go hand in hand. So here, what I want to reiterate is the fact that the treatment has to be whole. It should be both surgical and the medical treatment, unless both the treatment, both amphotericin, the surgical debridement, it cannot work as individual. I will give medical treatment or I'll give surgical treatment. That does not happen. So there should be a good multidisciplinary team for the effective management of this mucormycosis. So most of the talk is based on the editorial by Dr. Santosh Hanawar in the Indian Journal of Ophthalmology this month. And most of us, this is a very important article for staging and also for a uniform guidelines regarding management. Most of you would have read this, and it has all already been shown here. And the ophthalmologist's role come in this stage. So we have stage 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we will go into these stages. So stage 1 disease is basically in the anterior nasal cavity. So this is stage 1, when it is only an involvement of your anterior nose. The sinuses are not involved. Stage 2 disease is when your sinuses are getting involved. Okay, so this becomes stage 2. And stage 3 disease is when your orbit is involved. So orbital cavity is involved. So my talk is based mainly on the treatment of this orbital component. Now, stage 4, what is stage 4? So once the disease goes into the brain, so here is stage 4 disease. So it either enter into the brain cavity, either through the cribriform plate, either through the orbital apex, or through the sphenoid sinus, or through blood vessels. That becomes stage 4. Okay. So these are the 4 stages as per the this article. So in the stage 3, that is involvement of the orbit. So we have again 3A, 3B, 3C, and 3D. Let's go into the details of these with the help of some clinical pictures. So before we go into the stages, again, as I told you, a lot of patients come and seek help, basically because they are COVID recovered and they have some redness in the eye. So if a patient comes like this with a small amount of redness, do we consider it as mucor or not? As I told you, just by looking at this picture, many of the ophthalmologists also, when in a non-COVID era, would just brush it off as a simple conjunctivitis or episcleritis. But here, the important thing is to order for an imaging. Okay, so if a COVID recovered patient is presenting with any eye symptoms, even a mild redness like this, please order for an imaging. Now let us see what happens to the imaging in this particular patient. If a CT scan is ordered for this, you can see very nicely the ethmoid that is full. A normal ethmoid or any of the sinuses appear black on a CT scan because this is air. So we have air here, which appears as black. But when the sinus is got affected, it loses its the radiolucency, and it appears grayish because of the growth by the fungus. So you can see here in the maxilla, there is fluid. The entire ethmoid is full. But then the orbit appears normal. So a better imaging modality, as Dr. Prashant has already reiterated, is an MRI. So with an MRI, we can appreciate the muscle swelling better. So in such situation, an MRI would be a better modality rather than a CT. So the same picture on MRI, you can see again, the ethmoid is involved. And you can appreciate that the opposite side ethmoid is also involved, which was missed in the CT. However, this particular person is very lucky with respect to the eyes. You can note that the extraocular muscles here, the medial rectus, the inferior rectus, are not appearing enlarged. And in the other films, we could also appreciate that the orbit as such did not have any hyperintensities. So from this picture, we have a take-home message. Between a CT and MRI, always prefer an MRI because that gives a better soft tissue delineation, particularly when the symptoms are mild. See, when the symptoms are severe, you wouldn't actually need imaging to help you. But in these kind of situations, when the symptoms are very mild, the imaging helps the clinician very well. So go with the contrast MRI. So stage 3A. So here in this thing, the eye shows redness, the sinus disease is there. So it is a stage 2 disease, but there is no need of any treatment to this particular patient as of today. But then we need a serial monitoring. So this patient needs a monitoring. If this person undergoes, definitely needs a ENT treatment. And following that, once the sinus disease is cleared and the patient is on an amphotericin, he may or may not have an eye involvement. Okay, so then let's go to the next stage, that is 3A. In 3A, there is basically the medial orbit involvement. Okay, in your entire orbit, only the medial orbit involvement. And here the vision is unaffected. So patient may have mild signs and symptoms, but definitely the vision is very good. So these patients on imaging will have ethmoidal disease. So you can see that the ethmoid is affected. You can see that haziness on this side. And look at the normal medial rectus muscle here on the right side. And look at the medial rectus on the left side, slightly thickened and hazy. So you can see all this haziness. So this becomes a 3A, and this person's vision, since it is 6x6, I would classify it as 3A disease. And treatment here, mainly we will go in for a retrobulbar injection for this case. Again, I'll come back to the details of the injection later. So 3B. So previously in 3A, we had only the medial orbital involvement, but in 3B, there is a diffuse orbital involvement. Okay, the involvement is not limited to one quadrant, but more than two quadrants. If this is your orbit and you divide it into four quadrants, either this way or this way, so there is involvement of at least two quadrants, either the medial and inferior, and more than two structures like muscles or the orbital apex, like that. So that is a stage 3B, and here also the vision is unaffected. So even 3B can be treated with an amphotericin B injection. Let me reiterate the fact that again, with when I tell amphotericin B injection, it goes hand in hand with the sinus debridement and the medical treatment. Now going to 3C, that is when the posterior orbit is involved. So if you have the orbit like this, your eyelids are here, your globe is here. Most of stage 3 disease fits into this posterior part. Okay, so this is where you have the posterior orbital involvement in stage 3C. So here the manifestations are a central retinal artery, because we have, just look at this optic nerve here. So we have the optic nerve and through which the central retinal artery passes. So when the artery gets occluded, we have a central retinal artery occlusion, and which in turn leads to loss of vision. And here we have our superior oblique fissure. So this is our superior oblique fissure that can get involved. And we have a superior ophthalmic vein running over this side. So that can get affected, the inferior orbital fissure and the apex of the orbit itself. So these disease, which can be very well picked up on your imaging assisted by your clinical findings, all fit into stage 3C. So let us look at some clinical pictures. So here we have a diffuse orbital involvement. By diffuse, I mean all the quadrants. All the quadrants are gotten involved. And you can see there's a lot of chemosis. The patient's extraocular movements are limited in all the cases. So extraocular movements are limited. And the vision is no PL. So that is no perception of light. So this is definitely 3C. This patient again is stage 3C. We have been getting a lot of young patients as early as the youngest patient that I have seen is a 20-year-old. So we are seeing a lot of patients like coming in 3C disease. I guess most of the patients may be pre-diabetic prior to having COVID, and additionally with the steroids, the COVID disease itself and the mental stress that they undergo with the ICU admission, staying away from home, all predispose to this mucormycosis in very young patients like this. And yeah, so some present with an extensive proptosis, extensive symptoms. Surprisingly, most of these patients in at this stage do not have pain. That is because the orbital apex, which transmits all your nerves, are also affected. So somehow they look very comfortable, but then they are toxic. And another young patient here, this is the picture which I wanted to highlight, the white eye. There is no congestion, no inflammatory symptoms, but then look at the extraocular movements. Here the left eye is moving properly, but the right is moving well, but you can see that there is a limitation of the medial rectus over here. And same here, no movement on the left, no little limited movements on the upward and little less on the downward movement. So these are the patients which again go into stage 3C. Usually most of these patients have vision impairment. Some may have normal vision, but eventually progress to no vision later on if untreated. So this is a normal fundus picture here. You can see the reddish appearance of the fundus. And this is your macular area. And this is your optic disc. And we have the blood vessels going like this. While the picture on the left is that of a mucor patient having a central retinal artery occlusion. So you can see that the vessels are not seen very clearly. And what you are seeing here is the cherry red spot. Since the retina has become ischemic, the macula stands out. Since the macula is a pigmented area on the retina and the rest of the retina is usually transparent, the macula stands out in the picture. And the retina, which was transparent initially, allowing the choroid to be seen underneath, has now become opaque. And now you can't see the choroidal glow. And so that is the central retinal artery occlusion that you see in these kind of patients. Also, this same central retinal artery goes back in as the ophthalmic artery from, again, that in turn originating from the internal carotid artery. So it's a potentially dangerous situation that we are dealing with. The fungus traveling within the arteries as like a free highway and entering into the brain. Some of the patients also do come with eschar on the skin. So this is almost perforated on this place. It's in a very advanced stage. And when patients, so this patient had these are very, very advanced stages. 3D is bilateral orbital involvement. As you can see, the left eye here, it's already perforated, and the right eye is having a complete ophthalmoplegia. So this is stage 3D, which carry a very, very grave prognosis. The complications has been very beautifully explained by Prashant. And again, the cause for the complications is the direct extension through the tissues, like palatal involvement, as you are seeing here from the sinuses directly into the palate like this, and adjacent structures, which he has already mentioned. And the fact that this is a angioinvasive disease. So you can see the blood vessel over here, these are all the blood vessels through which into which the fungus invades. And because of this, we have a lot of complications. Like the same patient who had this bilateral involvement, you can see he has a occlusion of the ICA, the left ICA. So this is your left internal carotid artery. You can see that the whole of the left ICA is missing. See this, it's almost as if it's not there. So eventually we lost this patient because once it is in the brain, the prognosis is quite bad. So Prashant has already told most of them end up with strokes, the hemiplegia, brain abscess, and all such complications. So coming to the treatment part by the ophthalmologist, again and again, I'm putting the same slide, early recognition of treatment. So it has to be a very, very early intervention, high index of clinical suspicion, confirmation of diagnosis, and initiation of aggressive surgical and medical treatment at the earliest. So a team with a lot of these members in the team works the best. So the role of the ophthalmologist is in the initial assessment to grade the disease out of 1, 2, 3, 4. If the eye is involved, it goes directly into stage 3 disease of rhino-orbital cerebro CNS neocornicosis. That is the assessment part. And the retropulpar amphotericin B injection, excentration when required, and follow-up of all these patients. Many of the patients who had only sinus disease needs to be followed up for involvement of the eye as and when it occurs. So the same chart that has been shared earlier, here is the role of the ophthalmologist. So it's 3A to B and 3C to D. So to simplify this, I just made two columns. Whenever the disease is 3A and B, the choice of treatment is retrobulbar amphotericin B. 3A to B is when the vision is not so badly affected, but the orbital involvement is there. C to D is when your vision is bad, and of course, bilateral, it's very, very difficult to manage. Again, these stages are not stationary. A person with stage A today may progress to B, B may progress to C, C to D. So it's a very, very dynamic treatment that we are going to do. I may have planned for retrobulbar injection today while I'm taking the patient to give the injection if already the vision has become PL negative. So as the fungus progresses in hours, our thinking also must progress in line with the fungus and treat them accordingly. So how do we give this retrobulbar amphotericin B injection? So the amphotericin B injection that is advised is liposomal amphotericin B, but whatever amphotericin is available as of now, you could use. You could also use the conventional, that's the deoxycholate form. And this is 50 milligrams per vial. And we need a dosage of 1 ml containing 3.5 milligrams of the drug, okay? So for this 50 milligrams of the drug, what we can do is we can add 10 ml of 5% dextrose. So that will give me 1 ml containing 5 milligrams. So now I want 3.5 mg to go into the orbit. So I can take about approximately 0.7 ml of this solution and add 0.3 ml of dextrose and give a retrobulbar injection. So I think I'm clear with this preparation. So because this is a simple thing which anybody, anywhere can do, all ophthalmologists will give retrobulbar injections, peribulbar injections for cataract surgery. So any ophthalmologist can do this treatment. So this is how the drug looks once it is reconstituted. And the injection per se, I'm here demonstrating the medial approach, transconjunctival approach. So the injections, basically you have to give as per the, there are no clear-cut guidelines for all this because there have been only case reports. So if your disease is medial, then better you can use the medial approach. So in that case, you can inject in the medial quadrant. If your disease is inferior, basically by extensive maxillary sinus involvement, then you may give it in the inferior quadrant. So most of the time, our disease starts in the medial or in the inferior orbit because of the location of your maxillary sinus here and the ethmoid sinus here. Okay, so that's where we will be giving the injections. So let me just show you the injection. Most of the time we give the injections for DCR surgeries like this. So that is how the injection is given. I have already anesthetized the eye by giving a 2 ml of local anesthetic. So I'm going just below the caruncle, deep inside, just under the caruncle, taking care not to hit the eyeball. Withdraw and then inject. Okay, so this takes care of the disease medially. Same way, if the disease is inferiorly, you could give the injection in the inferior quadrant, either through the skin or through the conjunctiva. Okay, so that is about the transcutaneous or transconjunctival retrobulbar amphotericin B injection. So this can be repeated 4 to 5 times depending on the response. So if you give on day one and the next day you see if the vision is stable and the movements have not got affected, you could repeat another injection like that. You can maintain till the vision doesn't drop. In between, let's say you gave 2 injections and the vision dropped, better consider or complete if ophthalmoplegia occurred, then abandon these injections, go straight away to excentration. That's what our treatment modalities are, very, very dynamic in this case. So coming to excentration per se is a very, very destructive procedure. And almost the moment we tell this to the patients, attenders, their morale is very down. They're already depressed. And face, generally everyone wants to look good, however they are. And in a condition where we are even worried about pimples, excentration, it does cause a lot of stress on the person. However, but very, very life-saving procedure. We have to convince them to go ahead with the excentration. And as such, mucor is an angio-invasive disease. So in pre-COVID situation, almost we never had any bleeding in excentration. But here, since we are
done,
sir.
Kel sir,
illa madam, don sarpa issue ide sir.
Madam issue, okay,
one nimisha join aagtare sir.
Okay, sorry about this technical glitch. So I was talking about the excentration. So whenever the bleeding in these cases is not, it's a little higher than our regular things, like regularly how the mucor was there earlier, it's not so so it's mainly because of this heparin and anticoagulants. The anterior part, when you're dealing with the skin, you may have some amount of bleeding, but when you're going posteriorly, the bleeding actually is very, very minimal. And the end point for our excentration is to get some bleeding at the orbital apex. So you have to excise all the tissues, leave a bare bone to get some amount of bleeding at the posterior apex till the all necrotic tissue have been removed. So I'm just sharing a video of the excentration. So some of you may, non-ophthal people may feel difficult to see this. Viewer discretion is expected. Like you may just stop it at that time. So here I have tagged the upper and lower lid with sutures and about 4 to 5 millimeters from the lid margin. I'm using a Colorado needle. Is the video playing? Gautam, is the video playing?
Yes, yeah, video is there, but yeah, it is playing very slowly.
Yeah. Okay, okay. So yeah, basically in this particular image, what I wanted to show is that you tag the lids and you take about the incision 4 to 5 millimeters below the lid and separate the orbicularis. Just leave only the skin and go till the orbital margins. Okay, so that was the first thing. And now you can see here in this particular picture, I have incised the skin and I have retracted the skin over here and I'm reaching the orbital margin. So we are going to the orbital rim and using a monopolar cautery. So most of the centers will have a monopolar cautery and this helps us in controlling the bleeding. See, that's what I was telling you. Earlier days, we never used to have this much bleeding. But here, because of the heparin, there will be bleeding, but we cannot stop these drugs. If we stop, the patients are at risk of COVID-related clotting. So here, we separate the orbital contents, basically lower part, the inferior orbital nerve and the attachments, the inferior oblique, the lateral canthal ligament over here, superiorly the superior oblique tendon, medially the medial palpebral ligament. So these are the attachments and once these are separated and you are just below the periosteum, it's very easy to separate all the contents, okay? So once these contents, see, I'm here, the inferior oblique muscle over here. So ensure that you are below the periosteal plane because if you don't reach the periosteum, then everything comes bit by bit. So just pass your finger around to see if all the tissues are separated. So once you ensure the tissues are separated and adequate cautery, particularly to the superior supraorbital vessels and the infraorbital vessels, you can see that all of the contents are separated from the periosteum. So with the periosteum, we are going to pull the orbit out and removing end block. So using a heavy scissors, the whole tissue is being removed. So after this tissue is removed, we have to clear the orbital apex because with the scissors, we won't be able to clear the orbital apex. So this is the specimen that is removed and here is the orbital apical contents. And though that's the important part. See, till now what we removed was the anterior part, which may or may not have the disease. But this is the area which has the disease. See, this is the periosteum, which I'm separating with the periosteal elevator. You can see already the ethmoid is open here. It's already been operated. The sinus part was finished by the ENT surgeons. And I'm after that, I took over. So sometimes the ethmoid will be open. You can see the inferior orbital wall, which is necrotic. So all that has to be cleared and the orbital apex, take your time to clear the orbital apex because this is the area with the fungus. And the central retinal artery, the ophthalmic artery and your superior ophthalmic vein, all your neurovascular bundle, everything exits from this area. And this is your orbital specimen from the back side, and here this is your optic nerve that you was able to see the optic nerve here. The globe is hidden inside this orbital tissue. Notice that you have this necrotic tissue over here. So this is all necrotic. This area is necrotic. This is necrotic. This is definitely necrotic. Okay. So all the areas which are bleeding are healthy, and the areas which are not bleeding are unhealthy, and as I told you, the content after the orbital apex is important. So this is the area which we have to clear the most. And this is the ethmoid which is open. You can see that here the bone is starting to appear blackish over here. So the apical clearance is very, very important because right from there, it can go into the brain. And the skin is sutured for with the continuous spike. And here, what are the medical treatment? Again, see, only excentration or only sinus debridement is not going to help and the medical treatment part is elucidated very nicely when amphotericin is there, when it is not there. We can also lavage the orbital. In pre-COVID days, we had the luxury of lavaging the orbital apex, the sinuses. But currently, when the drug itself is not available, sometimes we can't waste the drug for this. So recommendations has been already dealt with by Prashant. Follow-up care, again, what is the most important thing in the follow-up care? When you have given the injections, is the eye getting involved? That is the major thing. So once you have done the X-ray excentration, there is not much of our role. But when it is only a retrobulbar injection that's been given. So if the injections were given, we have to follow up for any changes that occurred. Is there any disease progress? After the excentration, of course, the socket thing. So once this is like definitely going to take 2 to 3 months to have this kind of picture. And the most important stage at that thing is to avoid the disease progression and also the COVID morbidity. So most of these patients are COVID positive. So that medical role is very, very important. And finally, once the patient is recovers from all this and the socket epithelialysis, we can go with the prosthesis. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Chinmay. That was an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Hand over the podium to the moderator. If there are any questions, we will be ready to take it.
Okay. Dr. Rupashree?
Yes, sir.
Please carry on.
First of all, good evening to everyone. And I would like to thank Dr. Nagraj, Dr. Ravishankar, Dr. Prashant, and Dr. Chinmayi for giving in-depth and clear information about mucormycosis. And I would like to say that this presentation has drew many participants and held their attention for almost 2 hours. Thank you for taking out your valuable time. And let me go to the question, sir. Sir, this is a question, like basic question from Dr. Subhash. As the condition is associated with a lot of inflammation, what about the severity of pain? Will it be very painful?
Ma'am, can I take this? So as I told you, in the orbit particularly, since the nerves are getting affected, most of the patients do not have ocular pain as such, but they may have a very severe headache. And also the pain is an important finding for us if at all there is further spread. But it's not commensurate with the symptoms.
Okay. So it will not have much.
Yes, yes. Because the nerves are getting simultaneously affected. Your sensory supply on the orbit part particularly, it's coming from the trigeminal nerve, which exits from your superior orbital fissure. And so since the apex gets involved, most of these patients may not have initial part, they do have, but if the disease is extensive, they do not have pain. But they do have a lot of hemicranial pain, a lot of headache. I think Prashant can take up this question.
Prashant sir, would you like to comment on this?
Ma'am, as what Dr. Chinmay told very rightly, the initial part is the one which they start complaining of pain. And this is where most of the times it gets neglected because we think that the patient has fever, body ache. So headache will be taken as a passing by symptom there. It can be a symptom of mucormycosis, but that depends on the extent of involvement. That's first thing. Second part is the later part where the disease actually starts progressing. As what Dr. Chinmay rightly said, it can become painless. So that is the masquerading symptom there. That's the reason why its early diagnosis is very important here. Because pain may not be the actual feature here and it cannot correlate with the severity of the disease.
Okay, very nice information, I think, sir. So we have a hand raise option by Dr. Jyoti. Please ask your question. Dr. Jyoti.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. My husband has recovered from COVID. It's almost maybe 20 days. Since 2 days, he has... he complained of left redishness in the left eye. but it was only in the inner canthus. He doesn't have any pain or anything, only there is reddishness. He put Ciprox drops and it has reduced bit, but it has increased in the downward conjunctiva a little bit, but it has reduced in the inner canthus. He doesn't have any pain or anything. He is not diabetic also. So I wanted to know, madam, what to be done.
That's what, ma'am. If he is a non-diabetic person, but COVID recovered, if the steroids were used, he may have become diabetic now. So it would be good to get a HbA1c and RPS on as of this day. And if the sugars are raised, it would be good to go ahead with the MRI of the paranasal sinuses and the orbit. However, if the blood sugars are not raised, we could wait for a day or two to see if there's any, particularly if the vision is 6x6, like if has very good vision and do not have any eye movements affection, then non-diabetic as of today. See, non-diabetic previously is not our thing. Today is he diabetic because of the steroid use. So that is a very, very important thing. If he is diabetic, I would strongly recommend you to go ahead with the imaging MRI to see if the ethmoids are involved, because as I showed you in that first picture, many times it may be very mild, but do not worry if he has not become a diabetic.
Okay. If he is diabetic, then only I need to go for MRI imaging. If he is not diabetic, then no problem. Yes. If the HbA1c
then is no problem for today. Yeah, ma'am, no problem for today. Again, it's like you evaluate once again tomorrow. So the, as I told you, it's only hour by hour. Like every because that's how the fungus grows. So today is fine, but keep watching.
Excuse me, ma'am. HbA1c.
Yeah, I just want to come in there. HbA1c is not actually useful here because HbA1c is an aggregate of 3 months. Now these patients are given steroids in the acute phase, so a fasting blood sugar and a postprandial blood sugar will be more appropriate here. So if it is deranged, definitely go in for imaging and early consultation, because these patients need time for HbA1c to really be escalated.
Okay.
And many of these patients are anemic also, because they would have lost blood because of poor synthesis, many other reasons also, anticoagulants would have been used. So they must have lost some blood also. So anemia is a confounding factor. HbA1c can be falsely elevated or falsely low. Better go for fasting and postprandial blood sugar. And if it's deranged, definitely go in for an after consultation.
Okay, sir.
Can I intervene? Can I intervene?
Please, sir.
Yeah. Actually, what I personally feel is, in this particular case, there is a patient with one red flag sign in the eye. Probably the patient might be having something in the nose which can be missed. So I think it is mandatory that this particular case has to undergo a diagnostic sinuscopy. And if there are any changes in the sinuses, simultaneously a material can be taken for biopsy, the sinus lavage, or the secretions there can be sent for a KOH mount, which is very simple. Then I think that is one thing which you should not miss here.
Yes.
He doesn't have any nasal discharge or anything. No headache, nothing is there.
But basically, for it to come to the orbit, it has to come through the nose itself. So sometimes it can be a silent one. Sometimes in a diabetic, it might not be so clinically presenting with a lot of symptoms and all those things. Better to get a diagnostic endoscopy also, nasal endoscopy.
Nasal endoscopy has to be done. Okay, sir. Where can I get it done?
Whichever place you are staying, ma. There, probably a medical college there, you'll be having a... ENT surgeon with an endoscope, we can go there.
Right, ma'am. I'll take up the next question. So this is a question from a maxillofacial radiologist specialist from an RV Dental College, Dr. Revan Joshi. So he says, in the last week, he has come across with few cases which have been referred for cone beam CT of maxilla of post-COVID patients with a toothache. And the CBCT presents signs and sinusitis in both maxillary and ethmoid sinuses. So he wants to know what should be their line of reference. Once they rule out the dental cause of pain, should it be referred to MRI directly or wait for an ENT opinion before going ahead?
I think Dr. Ravi Shankar should answer this.
Ravi Shankar, sir?
Ravishankar, okay. Sir, please. He's there, sir.
He's there?
Yeah.
There. Yeah. Yes, ma'am, I'm ready. Tell me.
Okay, shall I repeat the, okay, I'll repeat the question, sir. This question from maxofacial radiology specialist. He wants to say that he has seen few cases in the last week, which are post-COVID, which are having this, and they have been referred for cone beam CT of maxilla, of and the CBCT presents signs and sinusitis in both maxillary and ethmoid sinuses. What should be their line of referral? And once they rule out the dental cause of pain, should it be referred for MRI directly or wait for an ENT opinion before going ahead?
We can try doing a diagnostic nasal endoscopy, try to isolate fungus if there is, or also determine is there any development of the disease, see any decayed material or infected area or blackish area. It definitely gives a good information. Take a representative sample from that part, you can send. If they are not there, as everyone is telling, we have to serially examine continuously till give supportive therapy, observe. If any new thing is developing, get an MRI done. Don't repeat CT. Get an MRI.
Right, sir. Right. So we have...
Dr. Evan Joshi, I would like to comment. This is a new disease and this is a old opportunistic infection occurring in a new disease. Lot of learning things are there. Basically, I think it should be taken care of in a center where there are a lot of other specialists readily available. See, from your whatever question you have asked, basically the patient has got sinusitis in the maxilla and the ethmoidal sinuses. Basically, the radiologist, I think you have been asked to do a CT. I think an MRI with a contrast would have been better to identify the extent of the pathology. And basically, the dental pain should not be the only criteria to say that this patient has to undergo a CT scan or a MRI scan. I think all patients with suspected MUCAR, the investigation of choice should be an MRI scan with a contrast. And basically, and you should observe the patient serially. And if you see there is a clinically worsening of the condition, every 48 to 72 hours, you should go ahead and do a MRI. That is my opinion.
Thank you very much, sir, for both the doctors who gave the inputs. I just wanted to bring out the context here. It is not very uncommon, sir, in the past week or so, we have seen at least 7 cases which had dental pain as the initial symptoms that they came up with, sir. And they are sent to us by dentists. Cone beam CT is predominantly used by us dentists. And they were referred by them to us. And it was not for the purpose of maxillary sinusitis that they had sent. Because it was a post-COVID case, we increased our field of view and covered the maxillary sinuses as well as ethmoid and sphenoidal sinuses in those CT scans. Now that there was no dental problem there and only sinusitis was there, and it was not very ominous looking sinusitis because you had the sinuses walls were intact, but only thing, they were involving all the sinuses, not just one side, both the sides, as well as one side turbinates were very swollen. So these probably, I spoke to my radiology colleagues in other field, medical line also, and they say that, yeah, this looks more like that, like mucor mycosis findings. So people can refer to an ENT or an MRI. But then what is happening is these guys find it difficult to get a person, sir.
Yesterday,
I'm going to talk to you.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're finding it difficult to find a nasal endoscopy thing, and that led to delay in one of the treatments, and finally it ended up with the ophthalmologist because the couple of days later the patient developed proptosis as well as swelling in the eyes. I don't know what happened later. So is it wise on our part to go ahead with the MRI, and would that be very
diagnostic? See, there was a classification and staging 1, 2, 3, 4. It doesn't mean that it should go from 1, 2, 3, 4. It can manifest in stage 3 directly also. Okay. Don't go by the idea that it will follow the sequence. Sequence is for us, not for mucus.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you very much, sir.
Right, sir. Okay, sir. Right, sir. A question from Dr. Gagan. Are hypertensive patients are affected by this mucor?
I will take this question, Dr. Prashant here. Madam, not necessarily, because hypertensive patients without any comorbid illness like immunocompromised status, steroid abuse, or being diabetic or anywhere else, they actually are apparently healthy individuals do not have any risk. It's your host immune system which actually combats this. So if you are healthy, it should not be a concern. And hypertension is not considered to be a disease. It's a disorder. So I think apparently there is no risk factor unless they have one of these risk factors along with hypertension.
Right. Okay, we have Dr. Manjula Jairam. Please ask your question.
Good evening, sir. This is Dr. Manjula Jairam, senior resident from BMC. Right? So this is for Prashant, sir.
Go ahead.
Sir, we had a young patient, 36-year-old male, diagnosed with mucormycosis, referred from NIMHANS. After a few days, after hospitalization, patient developed weakness in the right upper and lower limb, and CT was done, which was found to have left internal capsule, left capsuloganglionic infarct. But there was hemorrhagic transformation in the patient. So we thought it could be angioinvasion because of mucormycosis, but we were forced to continue anticoagulants, as we know it is a procoagulant state. But in this stage, do we have to continue anticoagulants in spite of knowing it is hemorrhagic transformation, or do we have to stop, sir? This was a dilemma.
First thing is, when the patient is having a hemorrhagic transformation, the risk-benefit ratio depends on whether hemorrhagic transformation is predominant or infarct is important there. First part. The second part is anticoagulation as such has no role in stroke management. Now, if you have anything else to really manage with anticoagulants, then acceptable. But that too, with a hemorrhagic transformation, be very careful while giving anticoagulation, because they may always go for a rapid transformation of hemorrhagic transformation can lead to cerebral hemorrhage and shift of the midline. So then the patient will worsen because of that only. So basically, anticoagulation is a very questionable thing when you have hemorrhagic transformation there. See, finally, it is about the risk-benefit ratio when you're giving any of these drugs. If you feel that the risk is greater than the benefit, please don't give them.
So in case of COVID as well, we have to stop the anticoagulation, sir, because we have not started the patient on antiplatelets thinking it is a angioinvasion because of mucormycosis. So in such a case, when we are giving a dual BD dosage of anticoagulants, because hemorrhagic transformation is there, like we have went ahead and stopped it, but there can be a thrombus formation and leading on to stroke or acute coronary syndrome because of the procoagulant state and mucormycosis. In such a case,
I agree with your question. That way, the coagulation can happen anywhere and the patient can die. That's not the part here. Suppose a patient has bleeding diathesis, will you give anticoagulation to those patients?
Definitely not.
So this patient now has an infarct there, which is going for hemorrhagic transformation. Ideally speaking here, the risk and benefit should be whether the patient requires an anticoagulation with respect to general management of procoagulant state, or this hemorrhagic transformation in the brain can transform it to a frank hemorrhage and lead on to further complications, leading on to midline shift and loss of consciousness. So many things can happen. So here the risk-benefit ratio has to be assessed on what extent the hemorrhagic transformation has occurred, and whether this anticoagulation is really useful systemically to prevent anything extraordinary here, because this patient is already with a stroke now. Now, if you're giving anticoagulation, there is no role for it somewhere already. I feel that the risk-benefit ratio is slightly towards risk rather than benefit here. Better manage with other things where you can manage, because here D-dimer becomes important. Is there any other organ involvement other than the lungs here? There's any multi-organ dysfunction, renal dysfunction, so many things come into picture. Ideally, I would say the risk-benefit ratio is slightly towards risk compared to benefit here. But that depends on the individual assessment there also.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Technically speaking, it's a very challenging thing to decide whether you need anticoagulation or not. But here, as there is already a hemorrhagic transformation, the risk of that hemorrhagic transformation increasing with an anticoagulation is more than the benefit that the patient is going to receive because of anticoagulation. So I feel it is judicious to stop anticoagulation in this patient.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any inputs from anybody is welcome there, because if anybody wants to add on to this, most welcome.
Okay. Shall I take up the next question, sir?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, madam.
A general question, sir. Some of the participants want to know, what are the center where mucormycosis can be treated? This is first question. And the second question is, what kind of measures can be advised to susceptible and the normal population in this?
I think the preventive measures, I think I have told in my presentation, the last slide of the presentation I have told.
Yes.
And the state government of Karnataka has released this thing also, slide also, which will give information on the red flag signs of probable mucor. And most important thing is the maintenance of oral hygiene and the COVID appropriate behavior and mask hygiene, I think, is one of the most important thing a general public has to do.
Right. So another
there's a very interesting thing that has happened in the second wave, which probably many of them have not noticed it. In the first wave, many of the patients did not require oxygen for a long time.
Correct.
They were all patients who were quite stable, and very few of them required oxygen, and the two maintenance oxygen for a longer time.
Right.
Now this session or the second wave has seen a sea of change. Many patients are oxygen dependent, and they're dependent for a long time. Now, hitherto, nobody paid attention what is the humidifier being used in these oxygen concentrators or oxygen vending machines, what was being used, how much hygienic condition was there for these patients, because they never stayed for a long period. Either they succumbed to the illness or they survived and went off. Now, this way, many patients are oxygen dependent for a long time. Now, this really mattered whether the hygiene actually what happens in developing countries or many other countries where hygiene is not being followed. So, simple things like replacing tap water by sterile or maybe distilled water, RO water, maintaining food hygiene, hand hygiene, nasal hygiene. All these things come into picture now because these precautions are never taken care of because they assume that COVID means only oxygen and nothing else, steroids and oxygen. Now, what happened now is the main part which you have been emphasizing from beginning is hygiene, which is never taken care of, has come into picture now. But if you maintain hygiene, you can avoid this. And it does not depend on steroids also. For your kind information, there are many patients receiving higher doses of steroids. And actually in COVID patients, we don't give very high dose of steroids at all. So abuse and misuse of steroids is probably quackery. Nobody should give it. Technically speaking, very small dose of steroids are being given. Dexamethasone 6 milligram once daily is what is the recommended dose. Sometimes methylprednisolone for 4 or 5 days. But heavy dose of steroids are never indicated in these patients. So steroid really leading on to mucormycosis probably is absurdity unless you are giving steroids unnecessarily for a prolonged period of time. Because one question popped up there, how long steroids should be given, long duration of steroids. There is no indication for long duration of steroids in any of these COVID patients and no indication for heavy dose of steroids. So I don't think it is steroid only which is causing this. Main problem is probably immunosuppression that's happening with these patients and the hygiene that we have forgotten for a long time. I think this is the main cause of resurgence of this fungus.
Dr. Prashant, they say this COVID itself is a diabetogenic condition by damaging the beta cells.
I have seen a few articles regarding that. We don't have any anecdotal reports which directly suggest any pancreatitis or pancreatitis-like picture in these patients or elevation of lipase in these patients where it suggests that the pancreas is getting damaged. But one thing is sure, this condition is definitely a pro-inflammatory condition and definitely a lot of stress is involved in this. Along with that, many of these patients are being given steroids, which probably acts as a challenge to patients who have borderline reserves in pancreas. So patients probably who are pre-diabetic or were having predisposing factors towards diabetes, probably they might have become diabetic during this pandemic. But we can't have an establishment that COVID patients directly landing up in diabetes because we don't have any anecdotal reports to suggest 1:1 correlation there, sir.
I've got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
We are seeing COVID, this mucor cases in active COVID cases also in the active phase right now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Basically, we have to treat COVID and we have to treat mucor also.
Absolutely.
Is there any drug interaction between the drugs which we give for COVID and which we give for mucor?
That's what, sir. I told you, sir. If some centers have been using caspofungin for non-availability of any of these drugs for management of this mucormycosis, caspofungin and dexamethasone have an interaction. So there, few patients who have been given dexamethasone, their caspofungin can have a drug interaction there. But other than that, most of the other drugs do not have any interaction with respect to, sir, as such, we are not giving any specific drug to COVID at all. Remdesivir does not have an interaction with any of these drugs, azoles for that matter.
Okay.
We are not giving any prolonged antibiotic medications or any other drugs which are constantly being used as antiviral therapy here. So basically, to be technically speaking, drug interaction as a consequence of COVID, very unlikely.
Okay, thank you.
Right, sir. So here is a question, sir. Half of it, I think you have answered regarding the steroids. So here, a part of the question, is there any other early oral manifestation that one can expect apart from the palatal perforation that is seen in severe cases? And second part is, can iron chelators have any role in the treatment of this condition?
The second part I'll answer right away, because the first part is probably an ENT department. Mm-hmm. The first part I will say, in fact, chelation therapy is one of the risk factors for mucormycosis. Desferoxamine therapy was one of the risk factors for mucormycosis. So mm-hmm. one thing. Second thing is chelation therapy is not common in medicine practice. And most of these conditions, what we are seeing in our setup, patients coming with that, we don't have any records till now, patients being given chelation therapy. So I think that part is a little out of context here. The first part, I think our ENT counterpart, Dr. Ravi Shankar, is the best person to answer.
Ravi Shankar, sir, can you take up this question, sir?
Ma'am, some of the, till Dr. Ravi Shankar comes, some of these patients had a looseness of the jaw. That is one of the, like people who have been operated for sinus or for the eye, when we go for post-op checkups, they do complain of this looseness of jaw, and that they clinically elicit. So that is one thing which I observed. Yes, sir, over to you, sir. I think Ravishan, sir is there.
Ravishan, are you there, sir?
So for one patient, they had actually, stabilized the jaw. And later, the face mask surgeon did come in and do some, removal of the necrotic, like deeper inside.
Right, right. Yeah. I think, again, Dr. Raven Joshi has a doubt. Please ask your doubts.
It's not actually a doubt. It's actually
input
that I would like to bring it to the last question. What happens in the regular CT scans is that they do not take the slice thickness which is diagnosable for dental regions. So they usually miss out on the spread, the trabecular thinning down and marrow spaces becoming bigger. And it gets overlooked upon when there's look, they don't see any perforation on the scan, on a CT scan when they go by two nice intervals. And that is where we end up with having a post-operative development of loose teeth or loose jaws at the end. So probably, cleaner look at the radiological part, we would have given the symptoms much before the operation was done.
Right, sir. Thank you for that, sir. And another question is blurring of vision is a danger sign, especially after taking steroids?
I will answer this, Dr. Prashant here.
Yes.
From the ophthalmic perspective, I think Dr. Chinmay will clarify that. But by giving steroids, what happens is the lens can swell. So the lens being a little, the refractive error of the lens changes because of the steroid therapy. So blurring of vision is quite common there. Sometimes because of hyperglycemia due to steroids, hyperglycemia itself can increase the refractive index of the lens. So there can be blurring of vision. So blurring of vision as such is not a sign of mucormycosis. But along with the other signs, what we have discussed so far, I think it becomes a sign of mucormycosis, not otherwise. Just by giving steroids, you have given steroids today and tomorrow your patient has blurring of vision. It is because of the effect of the steroids or on the glucose metabolism as such, but not due to mucormycosis.
Oh, yes, Prashant. Definitely, that is what is the thing. Like the immediate hydration issues with the lens is the immediate blurring that happens. Chronically, of course, you know the steroid cataract or glaucoma. In fact, steroids are indicated for vision loss whenever there is an optic neuritis. So going with that, steroid as such is will not cause blurring or blindness. In fact, it is a treatment with respect to optic neuritis. And so I don't think so it should be a cause for concern of blindness. Here in Mucor, the cause for blindness is the angioinvasion of the central retinal artery. It's not the nerve substance as such, but the CRAO. And of course, if the fungus directly invades the optic nerve, then that is the cause for blindness.
Right.
Yes.
Right. And here is a question. They want to know what is the average blood sugar levels where this is Mucor is common. Is there any availability of any?
No, there is no such correlation. In fact, we have seen patients who have had good control of diabetes after getting discharged also manifesting with Mucor mycosis. Most of the common patients, the common rule is poorly controlled diabetes. But there are patients where sugar is well controlled, still they can manifest with Mucor mycosis. I think it basically depends on the immune system rather than sugar control only. Of course, sugar does play a role there, but sugar levels correlating with Mucor mycosis, there's no correlation.
No. Yes, definitely. Like just a few patients who are on home isolation, non-diabetic, even not taken steroids, have also developed Mucor. As Dr. Prashant has told, it's basically to deal with the immune system rather than this. Yeah.
Right. And a question from Dr. Krupashankar. Is there any role of blue laser fluorescence in diagnosing Mucor? Blue laser fluorescence.
I am not aware of
not aware.
Probably a microbiologist or a pathologist would be
right. Okay, sir. Thank you. Yeah. And Dr. Gagan, he wants to know, maybe from past 2-3 days in news channels, they are showing regarding white fungus. So any comments on this?
See, let us stop isolating fungus based on the color only. Because as sir has already told, Aspergillus niger is actually the black fungus. Yes. It's not Mucor mycosis at all. See, it is the necrosis and the death of the cell of the skin which causes necrosis and causes black color discoloration in these patients. Mm-hmm. So white, black, gray, blue, pink, purple, so many fungi, it doesn't make any difference there. But sometimes it may so happen that you may have co-infections. Mucor mycosis may not come alone. It can invite so many of its friends, like aspergillosis can come, rhizopus can come, so many other things can come, candida can come. So it depends on what we are isolating. So white fungus, black fungus, it is fungus basically. So mm-hmm. Isolate the fungus, treat it, knock it off.
Right, sir. Mahendra, sir?
I think the media people should call it as killer fungus rather than as black fungus.
Anyway, the advantage for media is that many patients are presenting early. Before the eye involvement. So that's been in one way helpful. That's the only thing. In addition to the fear factor, some of them are presenting early so that we can salvage vision and life.
Mahendra, sir, shall we continue or we have...
How many questions are left?
Another 4-5 questions. Sir.
I think you can take last 3 questions and wind up.
Yeah, sir. Okay, sir. So, a question is, can it be advised in diabetic CKD with the VIVID positive status?
What? I didn't get the question. What is to be done?
Steroids.
No. Some MRI with gadolinium.
Gadolinium.
Can it be advised in diabetic CKDs?
Yes.
Any CKD gadolinium is a contraindication.
Yeah.
We usually don't recommend.
Yes.
Because it is nephrotoxic basically. Any contrast material, especially gadolinium, can also be definitely nephrotoxic. But if the patient is already on dialysis, perhaps we can give a course of dialysis, then give the contrast, then do it. But that depends on the discretion of the surgeon. If they want it, they want it. Because here it is life-saving. And if the patient is already on dialysis, yes. But if the patient is in CKD, but not on dialysis, patient may go in for dialysis there. So the risk-benefit ratio has to be decided whether it's life-saving or life-threatening.
Okay. Right, sir. So
I think we should take this question of healthcare workers, the risk to healthcare workers.
I was about to ask it. Is there any risk for healthcare workers that who are working with these patients?
I have already discussed that. It is not transmitted from person to person at all.
It is not a contagious condition.
It is not contagious. It does not spread from person to person or even from animals to person. It is only your own immune system, which if it's defective, it comes from the environment. It comes from poor hygiene. It does not come from anywhere else. So risk for healthcare workers is absolutely zero.
One of the things I would like to add here is a lot of our healthcare workers are COVID infected and they're put back to duty immediately. So this is one of the questions asked by one of my colleagues. So they are in the recovery period of that 1 month COVID. So probably if you are in that recovery period, maybe you can ask your thing to be shifted later. That's the only thing.
Yeah, that is very much suggestible because not only from the perspective of mucormycosis,
correct.
A second infection during the same period can be devastating. These patients who are COVID infective should be given adequate rest because after all, we are human beings.
Correct.
We should not be trying to be robots here.
Yes.
Treat them humanely, let them recover, they'll come back, they'll not run away anywhere. Once they have sacrificed so many things for the patient's care, they should be given adequate rest. Let them come back, let them take rest, let them recover.
Yes. So I'll take up this last question from Dr. Shweta. If patient presents with the black nasal discharge as primary symptom post-COVID, should they go for imaging or any other investigations? And how to differentiate orbital cellulitis due to other causes from mucor on CT or MRI?
In the present era, I think all cases of, we should see the clinical setting, whether the patient is having COVID symptoms or COVID-related symptoms. And the first diagnosis should be mucormycosis. Once you rule out mucormycosis, you should think about the other condition. That is the reason I told you should have a very high index of suspicion.
Suspicious.
I think the first question, I think Dr. Ravi is the right person to answer.
Ravi Shankar, sir?
I think he's not there. Another important feature between the bacterial orbital cellulitis and the fungal orbital cellulitis is that the bacterial cellulitis are extremely painful. Just like, so pain is a very important feature. So if you are having a lot of pain and fever, the signs of inflammation, then it is more likely to be a bacterial cellulitis. But a fungal orbital cellulitis, they usually do not have fever or those very inflammatory symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it's very important to differentiate between those two. And as sir has told, it's always better you consider them as fungus, like rule out fungus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So with this,
Dr. Rupashri and Mr. Gautam.
Question, sir.
Dr. Rupashri and Mr. Gautam, kindly announce the next program.
Hello.
Sir.
Gautam, kindly.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yes, Dr. Rupashri.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for all the speakers for giving such an elaborative answers. So I would like to inform all the participants, the entire program will be hosted on RGHS YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and also in the official website of RGHS. You can make use of the slides and information by watching it again. And the next program in our series is, it is on the evidence mining for adjunct and prophylactic therapy in COVID-19, addressing ivermectin and 2G. The talk will be delivered by Dr. U.S. Vishal Rao. And the timing is on 25th May, Tuesday at 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. Kindly log in for the program and make use of it. Over to you, Dayanand, sir.
Dr. Dayanand, please propose the vote of thanks.
Okay, thank you, Mahendra and Dr. Rupashri. Very good evening to all of you. On behalf of Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences, I thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor and Registrar for giving us the opportunity to host such educational programs. And I thank the speakers today, Dr. Nagaraju, Professor of Ophthalmology, Dr. Ravi Shankar, Professor of ENT, Dr. Prashant V, Professor of General Medicine, and Dr. Chinmayi, Associate Professor of Ophthalmology, for their wonderful talk and very clear and informative talk, very, very much appreciated by the participants. Today, there were nearly 600 participants were present, and also it is followed by very well answered by the speakers. And then I thank on behalf of the Vice Chancellor and Registrar, all the speakers. Thank you very much, sir. And I thank the our collaborator with Echo India, Gautam, for his coordination with our team. And then I thank all the participants for their very good interaction. And then they have waited for such a long time today, to the almost 2.5 hours. And thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, Nagaraj sir. Thank you, Ravish.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Chinmay madam. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Madam, thank you.
Gautam, can you close the meeting, please?
Yes, sir. Kindly fill the feedback form we are shared in the chat box.